program of reform and opening that Deng Xiaoping launched in the late 1970s was the source of this tremendous growth, double-digit growth, for the next 30 years. So that story is very familiar to many people in China and the United States, but what isn't remembered so much today is that actually the United States was very supportive of that progress. And in fact, we encouraged China's economic development. And here we are today, and we have a bitter trade war going on between the United States and China. Mutual trust between the two countries is at the lowest point that it's been in the 40 years since our relationship was normalized. Already you're seeing signs of the economic damage this is causing. It's slowing down that tremendous progress in China, and it's also having a damaging effect on the United States. We haven't seen all the damage yet. And because the United States and China are the two largest economies in the world, this has huge implications for the global economy. Certainly, I would say that the United States is primarily responsible for the way that the trade conflict has unfolded over the past 2 years. The Trump administration has not set clear objectives or a clear strategy. It has used tariffs, broad-based unilateral tariffs that are in violation of U.S. commitments to the WTO. The United States deserves a lot of blame for the situation we're in. One of the things that the U.S., EU, and Japan are working on is trying to get countries like China that are large and have a big impact on the system to change their designation of themselves as developing countries. Because from the perspective of the WTO and WTO members, China is not a developing country. China is the world's largest trading country, second largest economy in the world. 120 of the top 500 companies in the world are in China. Big source of the biggest source of foreign direct investment and recipient of foreign direct investment, very advanced technologies. I think that is the point that I'm trying to make about large economies have large responsibilities. Okay, so let me be fair and say the United States is also a large economy, the largest in the world, and we also have a responsibility, and we're not fulfilling that responsibility today by violating international rules and norms, including ones that we created. What do we do? What's the way forward? So let me suggest sort of three clusters of recommendations for China and the United States. Number one, stop doing harm. The two countries should pull back from this tit-for-tat retaliation and trade war and try to get back on a sort of more normal footing of their relationship. Secondly, the two countries, China and the United States, should work jointly and individually to improve the global commons, that is the global system. So in a range of areas, whether it's global health or sustainable infrastructure or climate change or piracy on the high seas, the US and China have a lot of shared interests in those issues, and they should be able to work together. And they have been able to work together in certain forums like the G20 or APEC. So I think they should do more of that, find more areas of cooperation. Final point is that China and the United States, this is my third recommendation, is that they should invest more in their domestic reforms that will provide stronger economies and healthier competition between them. So the United States needs to invest more in our own infrastructure, in our education, in research and development, and skills for the 21st century. For China, I think China should get back on the path of reform and opening. Now, I know a lot of people here say that China is on the path of reform and opening, but that is not the widely shared view around the world. I think there's an opportunity for China to surprise us. I call it the eyebrow test. If you can make our eyebrows go up, oh, that's a surprise. China's going to do that. That's what I think the rest of the world is looking for. I wish we could both be a little more confident, a little more open-minded, and find a way to get back to a more constructive relationship. But I think we have to be honest about these differences, and I think we have to understand there is competition, but competition's not necessarily a bad thing if it makes you perform better and if it's on a level playing field. But let's be, let's solve those problems, and then let's be responsible for the world economy and the world system as we are the two largest economies in the world. So thank you very much.
报告的题目就是怎么从小趋势出发去理解中国经济的演进。那我们先来解释一下小趋势这个概念。这个概念呢是一个美国学者马克佩恩提出来的，他曾经当过克林顿总统的战略顾问。那按照马克佩恩的定义，在美国占美国人口1%的人口，如果出现了一个新的现象，就可以叫做小趋势。2019年，中国的人口很快就会达到14亿人。好，那么14亿的1%就是1400万人了。我们现在来看，小趋势已经变得比大趋势更加重要。有三个原因。第一个原因，是因为宏大叙事已经结束。我们过去习惯的都是宏大叙事。20世纪80年代，我们讲的宏大叙事是改革。那现在呢？你再跟大家说改革，任何一项在中国的改革都一定会要触及到有一些既得利益集团的利益，改革会变得越来越难的。那你现在如果再继续跟大家讲对外开放呢？是的，中国还想继续对外开放，但是别人在搞保护主义啊。所以请你记住，宏大叙事的感染力已经下降，但是小趋势的感染力会提高。那么第二个原因是什么呢？是圈层社会已经到来。你是在你的朋友圈里面获取到信息的，在一个人的朋友圈里面刷屏的那篇文章，在另外一个人的朋友圈里面从来就没有出现了。去年的时候，在我们的朋友圈里面刷屏的文章，比如说 MeToo 事件，对吧？你到你爸爸妈妈的那个微信群里面去看看，从来就没有出现过，人家讨论的是保健品权健。但是万物之间是有联系的，在你所不熟悉的那些圈层发生的小趋势，会通过直接或者间接的方式会影响到你的人生。所以我们才要努力地突破我们自己熟悉的那个圈层，去当一个探险家，去了解在其他圈层正在出现的小趋势。那第三个变化，是中国未来一定会出现一场代际革命。我在这里要做一个预言，在未来30年，我们能看到的中国最大的一个变化，就是代际革命将会出现。老的一代会退出历史舞台，年轻的一代会登上历史舞台。那你就要想好怎么站队啊。在马云和马农之间，你站谁？我肯定站马农，996绝对不是一个浮粉。在王健林和王思聪之间，你站谁？我肯定站王思聪。电子竞技绝对比足球要更有发展前途。那么以后你会想想看，我们的员工、我们的顾客、我们的子女，都会越来越多的站在代沟的另外一边。所以你最好现在就学会怎么跟他们沟通和交流。好，那么接下来呢，我要告诉大家在什么地方我们能够更容易地找到这些小趋势。有三个地方，一个是底层，另外一个是边缘，第三一个是在年轻人当中。好，那么先看底层。你一定要到底层去寻找小趋势，永远不要低估人民群众的智慧。你要相信，当树叶飘零的时候，根系还在地下生长。那我们举个例子来说吧，我们看一个关于中国教育的小趋势。教育在中国现在是一个最大的社会问题之一。2018年， 我在四川省广元市宝伦镇狗村的范家小学看到中国教育的一个小亮点。这是在大山深处的一个很小的学校，28名幼儿园的学生，43个小学生，12个老师。在一个山区的学校，他的生活教学的条件肯定是非常艰苦的，这些孩子全部都是留守儿童，但是他是我见过的最乐观最开朗的一群中国孩子。农村学校的师生比越来越高，所以在范家小学是小班教学，一个班级里头5、6个孩子，最多的7、8个孩子。那我们看到由于没有师资的力量，所以他们现在反而是在尝试啊，现在在教育界里面非常流行的这种芬兰式的项目式的教学。这由于农村的家长现在已经对教育这成绩没有什么执念了，所以这个学校才能够回到教育的本质，回到教育育人的本质。那我给大家要讲的第二一个小趋势，就是你要到边缘地带去寻找小趋势，你要相信混搭才能够带来创新，在这些边缘地带更容易出现新技术的应用场景革命。我在新疆看到的极飞的无人机，它做的是农业植保机，它会降落在地头的尘土里面，它是村里面孩子最喜欢的玩具。在边缘地带正在爆发一场技术应用的场景革命，我把这个叫做中国技术进步的群众路线。所谓的群众路线，就是能够结合中国的工程师红利和市场红利，非常迅速地把应用技术应用起来，然后会用强大的市场的力量倒逼核心技术跟着自己一起演化。那我相信在未来会有很多技术会通过群众路线在中国生根发芽。我们总结一下，我们之所以去关注小趋势，实际上是我们发现了去观察中国的另外一个视角。我们在过去的时候讲中国的优势，都是喜欢讲说中国的优势在于规模很大。那我们发现，当中国的规模达到一定程度之后，它会变得更加复杂，我把它叫做复杂红利。那这些复杂的背后，实际上就会产生各种各样的突变。那这些突变是什么？这些突变就是小趋势。而那些最后能够适应环境变化，能够生存和发展下去的小趋势，最后一定会变成未来的大趋势。所以了解了小趋势，我们才能够更好地理解中国经济奇迹的秘密。谢谢大家。
Joined the EU, global trade policy and global trade relationships have not been conducted by the UK government, they've been conducted by the EU Commission. The relationship between China and the UK has, of course, over these years been conducted through the EU. And if the UK leaves the EU, that situation, of course, changes.From that point onwards, the UK will have to have its own global trading policy, and it will conduct its own global trade negotiations. And so, for example, if there is in the future a free trade agreement between China and the UK, it will be a direct bilateral relationship between the UK and China, and not between the EU.And China, although of course there may separately be a free trade agreement between the EU and China. The second obvious change from the point of view of East-West relationships is that the removal of the UK from the EU will have some effect on the attitude of the EU to its relationship with the rest of the world. The UK has traditionally been over the last 50 years, a highly open economy, and our policy under successive governments of different political parties has been to promote open global free trade. And so in all the discussions and arguments within the EU about the EU's trading relationships with China or with India, or indeed while we're at it with the United States, the UK has always been a voice in favor of openness and liberalization and free trade. And in that, we've normally been allies of Germany and some of the Scandinavian countries, and often on the other side of the argument, the French and the Mediterranean countries have been much more cautious about opening up and liberalizing trade. So clearly, when the UK leaves the EU, that balance is going to alter. And it may be that the EU becomes slightly more protectionist. But again, I don't think one should overestimate that effect. The UK is one of the largest European countries, one of the largest European economies, but it's still only one out of 28 European economies. When it removes itself, the EU will change somewhat, but it's not going to change dramatically overnight. I don't think that the trading relationship or the trade policy relationship or the free trade negotiations between China and the EU are going to be hugely affected by the UK removing itself from the EU. When the UK leaves the EU, the day after, all our regulations will be the same as the day before. Our Parliament has already, we have legislated to ensure that all the rules which were in place on the day we leave are still in place the day after. And only gradually will any of our regulations change. A huge part of our trade, the UK trade, will still be with the EU. In order to export to the EU, we will have to maintain the same product standards that we currently maintain, and they will have to match the EU standards as those standards change. For Europe and for the UK, Brexit has been a major distraction. It has focused a great deal of time and effort on an internal affair. My view is that rather than focusing on Brexit, what the EU and the UK both need to focus on is how the Europeans collectively can use the influence we can have over the United States to broker solutions between the United States and China and India that reshape the global system in a way that is comfortable for both the United States and for China and for India to live in, so that we can achieve a peaceful coexistence. So my message to you is, Brexit actually will come and probably go. And you probably won't really notice terribly much difference. And actually, nobody will probably notice in the end terribly much difference, except that it's a terribly difficult political transition in the UK. What will abide, what will remain, is this big issue of how both sides of the world accommodate to a huge shift in the power balances and the economic power balances of the world. And our task is to find a way through that where the Europeans play a constructive role in enabling the United States to reach an accommodation with Asia, and in particular with China, that avoids conflict and promotes peaceful coexistence. Thank you.
食品安全的话呢，在全球都是非常大的问题，在中国的话也是大家很熟悉了，有三鹿氰胺啊等等和一些其他的这些非常大的这种事件。另外呢，中国政府呢对这个食品安全也最近也是非常重视，投入了很多的资源。那么呢，这个习近平主席最近一次讲话是讲到民以食为天，食以安为先。另外他讲话里头特别强调了要在食品安全监管方面要加大 科技的支持力度，这就是我们麻省理工学院要做的事情，就是改变传统的这个监管模式，加入大数据，加入科技。我们研究的是中间这种情况，就是以经济的这个目的为驱动造成的食品安全的问题。我们不研究这个质量管理和故意捣乱破坏的这种场景。那么现在的这个监控的模式的话呢，是在你们的这个荧幕的左边这种监控模式，它是上游、中游和下游都是分开的，而且互相是没有任何联系的。我们想做的一件事情的话，就是要从这种当前的监管模式，通过大数据改变监管模式，成为一种可预测性的这种监管模式，就是你们的这个荧幕的右边的，就是上游的做的这个监管数据能够告诉下游和中游哪些领域应该更受到重视，哪些领域就可以不受到重视，是吧？这比过去的那种随机性的这种监管的这种模式的话呢，要更加的准确，而且成本呢更加对于政府来讲成本更加低廉。美国的这个它现在面临的这个问题的是什么呢？它从国外进口大量的这个食品，但是美国的这个食药监局根本没有人力和物力增加对这些进口的食品的这个检测，它的检测率非常的低，大概到1%-2%左右。所以他就跟我们商量，就是说呢，我们只能有这么多的钱，我们只能这么多的人来做检测，你能不能告诉我做一个定向的靶向式的这个检测。我们做的一件事情呢，就是把这个食品的这个供应链整体的数据从农场到这个制造，然后到了这个进口，做成一个大的数据库。过去的话，这些数据库都是分开的。另外呢，就是说这个政府在监管这些产品的时候，他是不知道这些产品的供应链的特征是哪些特征。另外的话，我们做的一件事情呢，就是把这个收货商提货的这些企业都是美国企业，它的这个特征做成一个数据库。我们现在在用同样的这种思维模式、模型方式来去针对中国的数据。从数据库上来讲的话呢，我们要建立这个几方面的数据库，一个是检测的数据库，一个是供应链的这个数据库，一个是监管的数据库，还有一个是环境污染的数据库。然后另外从这个从工具方面来讲，我们现在开发几个工具，一个是可视化的工具，还有一个很重要的是一个技术方面的一个工具，这就是快速检测。现在这个监管这个食品方面有一个非常大的障碍，就是快速检测的技术有很大的问题。它主要有四个方面的问题：第一是成本非常的高，第二的话它每次只能查一个污染物，第三的话呢，它的准确率达不到这个实验室的这个准确率，第四的话呢，它只能定性不能定量。我们现在 MIT 的这个技术的话，差不多在这个国内的话要做一个快速检测的话，差不多得要1000人民币左右，成本是相当相当高的。然后我们现在希望把我们的这个技术的这个成本降到5个美元，降到5个美元，这是第一。第二的话呢，它这一个这个快速检测的技术可以同时查140个掺假物，而过去的技术，现在的技术只能查一个。第三的话，它的这个准确度已经和这个实验室的准确度差不多，已经接近了实验室的准确度。第四个是非常非常重要的，就是我们可以定量，因为你要看食品安全法的话，它不是说你有杂物的话就是非法的，它是这样的话，如果你有这个掺杂物超过了多少%才是非法的。所以定性的这种检测的话，对于从法律角度来讲的话是完全完全不起作用，必须得定量才可以。我们现在这个技术就可以定量。在这个水产方面的话呢，实际上上游的这个风险的这个概率实际上是非常非常大的。但这里我发现一个非常有趣的这个现象，就是下游的监管的力度往往要比上游的监管力度要大要强，但实际上上游的这个风险的这个概率实际上是要比下游的风险概率要高很多。 我们的远景呢是要在 MIT 启动一个非常大型的这个长期的这个全球的针对全球的一个食品安全的计划。我们现在在东南亚也在印度进行相类似的研究。另外我们希望在中国建立一个研究的联盟，这个研究联盟有国内的大学的参加，也有企业的参加，给这个帮助政府帮助企业提出这个解决方案。另外呢，我们也非常希望跟政府密切交流，在这个中国的一个地区，比如说我们可以做一个试点，是吧，一个检测试点，是吧，现在实行的是一种随机性的检测，那我们现在是一种大数据的检测，如果我们的这个检测真正能够提高准确率的话呢，我们也希望这种模型能够被大规模的采用。